Hello everyone and welcome to the chapter number 56 of Blender Master course Introduction to Constraints. In this chapter, we'll be understanding about the concepts of constraints in Blender, and for anyone who is new to this course, you can check out the previous 56 chapters from the link of the playlist given in the pinned comment. Now the first question which arises is that what exactly are the constraints? So in Blender, constraint basically means to control the properties of an object, for example the properties of this cube like its location or the rotation or the scaling, by targeting this object to a secondary object in the scene. For example, if I press Shift plus A, then go to Mesh and select any other object, for example a cylinder. Let's also move it in the Y axis over here. Then now by using the constraints of Blender, I can control the properties of this cube object by targeting this object to the secondary object, which is the cylinder. Or in simple words, you can also say that the constraints help you to define a relationship between different objects in the scene. To access the constraints, click on this icon, which is the Object Constraint Properties. And if I click on Add Object Constraint, then here you will see a list of all the constraints available in Blender. Now each one of these has a specific function which we'll be learning in this chapter and the upcoming two chapters. Now in today's chapter we'll be covering all these transform constraints, then in the next chapter we'll be covering the tracking constraints, and in the following chapter we'll be discussing about the relationship constraints. We won't be discussing about the motion tracking constraints because they are not practically used much in Blender. So to begin with, the first constraint that we're going to explore today is the copy location constraint. So with this cube object selected, I'll go to the constraint properties, click on add object constraint, and in the transform select the copy location. Now as the name suggests, this copy location constraint will force the object on which it is applied to take up the location of the target object. So in the copy location constraint, if I go to target and click on this eyedropper, and with this if I select the cylinder object, then you will notice that the position of this cube will change. Moreover, if I try to move this cube by pressing G, then you will notice that we are not able to change the location of this cube, and this is because of the copy location constraint. Due to this constraint, this cube will now have the same position as that of the cylinder that we added. So if I select the cylinder, let's also scale it up by going to the edit mode so that we can see it properly in the scene. Now if I try to move this cylinder by pressing G, then you will notice that the same change in location will also get applied to the cube object. So this is the use of the copy location constraint. And if I select the cube again, then you will notice that we have two more options, the axis and the invert. So with the axis, we can control that in which axis should the location be copied. For example, if I turn off the Y and the Z axis, then in this case, the copy location constraint will only work in the X axis. So if I select the cylinder and try to move it in the X axis, then you will notice that the same change in position will also get applied to the cube. However, if I try to move it in the Y axis, then the position of the cube is not changing. Similarly, if I try to move it in the Z axis, then in this case also, only the position of the cylinder is changing and not that of cube. So in this way, you can control that particular axis whose location you want to be copied. Then you have the invert option, and if I select the invert in the X axis, then in this case, if I try to move the cylinder in the X axis, then you will notice that both of them are now moving in the opposite directions of the X axis. One of them is moving in the negative X axis and the other one is moving in the positive X axis. Similarly, if I turn on the Y axis and also the invert in the Y axis, then in this case, if I try to move the cylinder in the Y axis, then now also their positions in the Y axis are opposite to each other. So this is the use of the axis and the invert in the copy location constraint. Now moving ahead, just like the copy location constraint, you also have another constraint which is known as the copy rotation. So I'll select this one. Let's also remove the copy location constraint from here. So click on this cross button. And now just like the previous one, the copy rotation constraint will control the rotation of an object with respect to the other object. So if I go to the target and with this eyedropper, I'll select the cylinder. Now in the axis, all the three, that is the X, Y and Z, are turned on, and so if I select the cylinder and try to rotate it in the X axis by pressing R, X, then you will notice that the same rotation is being applied to the cube as well. Similarly, in the Y axis also and the Z axis as well. Then if I select the cube again and turn on the invert in all the three axes and select the cylinder again, with this, if I try to rotate the cylinder in the X axis, then you will notice that even if they are both rotating in the X axis, but their directions are opposite. Similarly, if I press Y for the rotation in the Y axis, then in this case also the direction of rotation is inverted, and in the Z axis also the rotation of both the objects is in the opposite direction. Now moving ahead, the next constraint that we are going to see is the copy scale constraint. So first of all, I'll remove this constraint by clicking on this cross icon, then go to add object constraint, and in the transform select the copy scale. Now for the target object, I'll click on the eyedropper and select the cylinder. Now just like the previous two constraints, the copy scale constraint is used to control the scaling of one of the objects with respect to the other object. So with all the three axes turned on, if I select the cylinder and try to scale it in the x axis, then you will notice that the same scaling effect is being applied to the cube also. Similarly, if I scale it in the y axis, then the cube will also scale in the y axis like this. Similarly, in the z axis also, if I change the scale of the cylinder, the scaling of the cube will also change. Now if I select the cube again, then in the copy scale constraint, we have one more option, which is the power. And with this, we can control the intensity, or basically the power with which the scale effect is to be applied. For example, if I increase the power to a value of 2 and select the cylinder again and try to scale it up in the z axis, then you will notice that in this case, the factor by which the scaling changes in the cube is much greater than before. So to summarize, we studied about three constraints: the copy location, the copy rotation, and the copy scale. And now the fourth one that we have is the copy transforms. So I'll select this. Let's also remove the copy scale. Now the copy transforms constraint will control the entire transformation of the object, meaning the location, the rotation, as well as the scaling with respect to some target object. So if I go to the target option and select the eyedropper, then I'll select the cylinder. Now you will notice that the position of this cube is now changed to the position of the cylinder. Also, if I select the cylinder and try to move it, then the cube will also get the same location. Similarly, if I try to rotate the cylinder, then in this case also, the same rotation will get applied to the cube as well. And similarly, if I try to change the scale of the cylinder, then now also, the same scaling effect will get applied to the cube in the scene. We'll be discussing about another constraint, which is the limit distance constraint. So first of all, I'll remove this copy transforms constraint by clicking on this cross button, then go to add object constraint, and from the transform, select the limit distance constraint. Now this constraint controls the maximum distance between the object on which it is applied and the target object. So let's understand it practically. First of all, I'll go to the target object, click on the eyedropper, and select the cylinder. Now in the distance, if I type 6 meters, then in this case, the maximum distance between the cylinder and the cube object will always be 6 meters. So if I try to move the cylinder in the x-axis, then you will notice that its location is getting restricted, and this is because of the limit distance constraint. Similarly, if I try to move it in the y-axis, then in this case also, the change in the location is being restricted because of the distance value of 6 meters in the limit distance constraint. Similarly, if I try to move it in the z axis, then now also the limit distance constraint will work, and this is how the position of the cube is being controlled. Now moving ahead, the next object constraint that we'll explore is the limit location. So I'll select this. Let's also remove the limit distance. Now this constraint will control the limit by which you can change the location of your object. For example, if I turn on the minimum x and keep the value to 0 meters, also I'll go to the maximum, let's turn it on in the x axis and change the value to something like 8 or 10 meters. Now if I try to move the cube in the x axis, then you will notice that I won't be able to move it in the negative x axis. However, if I try to move it in the positive x axis, then in this case, even if the cube will move, but the location will get restricted to that particular value which we'll input in the maximum parameter. Similarly, if I input 5 meters in the minimum and try to move the cube in the x axis, then in this case, the change in location of the cube is only possible from a distance of 5 meters to a maximum of 10 meters in the x-axis. Just like this, you can also try this with the y or the z-axis. So for example, if I change the maximum in the z-axis to something like 15 meters and try to move the cube in the z-axis, then in this case, the position of the cube will only go to a maximum of 15 meters in the z-axis and not beyond it. So this is the use of the limit location constraint. Now moving ahead, the next one that we'll explore will be the limit rotation. So I'll select this. Let's also remove the limit location. Also, to move the cube back to the 3D cursor, press Alt plus G in order to clear the location. Now just like the limit location controlled the location of the cube in the different axes, this particular constraint, which is the limit rotation, will control the rotation of the cube in the different axes. For example, if I turn on the Y axis and with the minimum value set to 0 degrees, I'll change the maximum to something like 45. Then in the 3D viewport, if I try to rotate the cube in the Y axis like this, then you will notice that its rotation in the Y axis is now locked from 0 to 45 degrees. Similarly, if I go to the x axis and in the maximum, if I type 90 degrees and try to rotate the cube in the x axis, then you will notice that the rotation of the cube is now limited from only 0 degrees to 90 degrees in the x-axis. Similarly, we have another object constraint, which is the limit scale. So first of all, I'll remove this limit rotation, then go to add object constraint, and in the transform category, select the limit scale. With this constraint, we can control the minimum and the maximum values to change the scale of this cube. For example, if I turn on the maximum in the x-axis and change the value to 1.5, then in this case, if I try to scale up the cube in the x-axis, then you will notice that the maximum value by which we can scale the cube is now restricted to 1.5. Similarly, you can try the same with the other axis also and with the minimum also. Like if I turn on the minimum x and change the value to 0.5, then in this case, the scaling in the x-axis is now locked from a minimum value of 0.5 to the maximum value of 1.5. So if I try to scale it down in the x-axis like this, then it will only get scaled down to 0.5. And if I try to scale it up, then it will scale up by 1.5. Now moving ahead, the next object constraint that we'll discover is the maintain volume constraint. But before that, I'll first remove the limit scale from here. And before adding this maintain volume constraint, I need to explain one simple concept to you. See, by default, each side of the cube, meaning the length, breadth, and the height is equal to 1 meter, and therefore the mathematical volume of this cube will be equal to length multiplied by breadth multiplied by the height, which equals to 1 meter cube. Or if I tell you in terms of unit, then the volume will be equal to 1 cubic units. Now if I go to the add object constraint and select the maintain volume, then this constraint will allow you to change the volume of your object with this volume parameter. And because the volume will change, so the length of the side should also change, which we can control with the free axis. For example, if I change the volume to something like 3, then now it will try to maintain the volume of 3 by changing the length of the sides according to the free axis. Similarly, if I change it to the x-axis, then in this case, the length of the different sides will change like this. And if I change the free axis to the z, then in this case, the length of the different sides changes like this. In simple words, whichever axis is selected over here, the length of the object will not change in that particular axis. You can also confirm it by changing the volume from here. Even if I reduce it or increase it, the length of the side in the z-axis is not changing at all. And this is the use of the maintain volume constraint. Now let's move to the last topic for today's chapter, which is the transformation constraint. Now you might think that we also have the transform cache in the transform category. However, this transform cache constraint is not commonly used in Blender. So for now, I'll be selecting the transformation constraint. Let's also remove the maintain volume constraint. And now this transformation constraint allows you to control the location, rotation, and the scale of the object with respect to some other object which will act as the target. So first of all, I'll go to the target, and with the eyedropper tool, I'll select the cylinder. Now I'll open the map from and the map to, and here you will notice that we are having so many options in both of them. So let's understand each thing one by one. First of all, you have the option to control the location or the rotation or the scale, and by using any of these, you can control that specific parameter of one of these two objects. So if you have opened the map from, then whatever changes you will do over here will be for the target object, which is the cylinder, and whatever changes you will do in the map to, these will get applied to the object on which the constraint is applied, or in this case the cube object. Now by using the transformation constraint, if I go to the map from and in the location, I'll change the maximum value in the x-axis to 10 meters, and in the map to, if I go to the rotation and change the value of maximum in the x-axis to 90 degrees, then in this case, when I'll move the target object, which is the cylinder, in the x-axis from 0 to 10 meters, the rotation of the constrained object, which is the cube, will change in the x-axis from 0 to 90 degrees. So if I select the cylinder and try to move it in the x-axis like this, then here you see that with the change in location of the cylinder, the rotation of the cube is also getting changed from a value of 0 degrees to 90 degrees. Similarly, if I select the cube again, then you can do the same thing with the other parameters also, like the scaling or the rotation. Then you can also change the parameter in the map to, which is controlling the cube, like the location, rotation, and the scale parameter. So basically, with the transformation constraint, you will use the map from to control the transformation of the target object, and that change in transformation will be used to control any one of the three transformations of the constrained object, which is the cube. Also, one more thing to notice here is that if I select the location in the map from and the rotation in the map to and try to move the cylinder in the x-axis, then you can clearly see that the change in the transformation is working only at a particular value of location which we have set in the transformation constraint, which is 0 to 10 meters in the x-axis. However, to make this process infinite, you simply need to turn on the extrapolate option over here. So if I turn it on and try to move the cylinder in the x-axis, then in this case, the rotation of the cube will keep on changing every time the position of the cylinder changes in the x-axis. So this is how the transformation constraint and the other constraints in the transform category work in Blender. And with this, we now arrive to the end of the chapter number 56. Our next chapter will be the chapter number 57, tracking constraints in Blender. So don't forget to subscribe to our channel, press that notification bell so that you can get timely updates about the upcoming chapters. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you in the next one.